Morning everyone, I'm Suruchi and today we're going to be discussing being a brand and not just representing one. So what age do we live in? We live in an age which is very competitive. If there were 100 people going to school 100 years ago, there were 1,000 going to school 10 years later, 1 lakh after that, and millions and scores and billions now. We all have to stand out. What is the world looking for? Even if you go out to shop, you look for something extra. World is looking for extra cheese. I want my burger with extra cheese. So give it to them. No harm giving it to them. What is that extra cheese? Let me rephrase and say that extra cheese is a brand. It's being a brand. Each one of you as students have to be brand ambassadors. To who? Not just to your institute, not just to the course that you're representing, not just to the company you will represent tomorrow, not just to the product you would be selling, not just to the service that you would be offering, but a brand ambassador to yourself. You have to be brand ambassadors professing yourself and standing out and being that extra cheese that everyone is craving. Human beings by nature want to associate because of the why and not for the what. What does this mean? Let me stretch your imagination a little bit. Imagine that you're walking along Colaba Causeway. Everyone familiar with Colaba Causeway? You're walking, strolling along Colaba Causeway. You're seeing lots of vendors with scarves hanging, with trinkets hanging, with watches and belts hanging. Lovely stroll. Now, as you're walking along Colaba Causeway, you see a little kiosk there, which has a big board outside, which says, "We sell genuine Rolex watches." Would you believe them? Would you trust them? I wouldn't trust them. Why not? Because when you look at that kiosk and you say this tiny little dull rundown kiosk in this environment, could it really be selling genuine Rolex watches? I don't think you'll walk in and buy one. I don't think you'll walk in and buy one even if they were giving it to you at 100 the cost of a genuine Rolex. Now let's twist your imagination a little bit. Cut to take two, and what do you see? You see Katrina Kaif walking out of that kiosk sporting a fancy Rolex. Or, okay, you see a Hrithik Roshan coming out with a snazzy little Rolex. Are you going to stop and notice? I would stop and notice. Are you then, if you had the money, are you then going to stop and say, this is a kiosk that I should give a chance to? If Katrina Kaif thinks it's good enough and this kiosk can sell me a genuine Rolex, or if a Hrithik Roshan thinks that this Rolex is good enough to be on his wrist, I think it's good enough. Chances that you're going to walk into that kiosk and buy a Rolex are very, very high. Why did you do that? Did you buy it simply because you wanted that Rolex? Did you buy it simply because you wanted to patronize that kiosk? I don't think so. You did it because you want to associate with that feeling of admiration, that feeling of I stand out, that feeling of I'm that extra cheese that Katrina Kaif and Hrithik Roshan represent to you. Is that not right? When I wanted to buy a health supplement, I instantly said, I'll go for Revital Woman. Why not? Because the first thought that came to my mind was, Salman Khan and his family endorse Revital Woman. There are so many good supplements, but I wanted to associate with that feeling of strength and health that they exude to me. So keep in mind that most of times, not just you as consumers, but even counterparties that you interact with on the other side of the table, associate with the why. The what is only a catalyst which satisfies that why. That why represents their need. The need to feel admired, the need to stand out, the need for everyone to look up to them. And that what, that Rolex, only represents that need. So are we on the same page as far as the why and the what? Once we understand the why, we will be that much more better equipped to understand why that branding or self-imaging assumes so much importance in this day and age. Why should we be a brand? It's a world of first among equals. I don't know how many of you have referred to the Brand Equity Most Trusted Brand Survey of 2012, which was published in the Economic Times recently. What are the brands that feature in that? Brands we are very familiar with. A Dettol, a Maggi, a Lifebuoy, a Nokia. So tell me, why is it that these established brands, these very big brands, also feel the need to compete and to ensure that they make it to this list? Because branding is such an important aspect of our lives. It's not just a brand which is a stamp, but it means trust. It means someone wanting to look up to that brand versus someone who's not a brand. A Coca-Cola is a brand. A Wellington Institute is a very big brand. But tell me, there are thousands and thousands of students at Wellington Institute. If tomorrow I had only 2 seconds to pick two students from thousands of students at Wellington who I wanted to give a really good job to in a Fortune 500 company, and I assume that everyone's capabilities are the same, I have screened and these 1,000 students have met my expectations of gradations, how will I pick those? I will go for the ones who stand out immediately. If I ask a professor, I will go for the ones who stand out immediately. Again, coming to the why, which I feel is so important, because you cannot start branding yourself. You cannot start professing your self-image. You will not start genuinely working on it till you accept that being a brand is important. Lot of us resist it. Lot of us say, my work speaks for itself. My grades speak for myself. The product speaks for itself. The fact that I am from this institute speaks for itself. Lot of us resist it. It may not be in our personalities to go about talking about ourselves. But we need to understand that it's very, very important today. And till you understand that why, you will keep resisting and grudgingly indulging in the how. Let me give you an example of this lady called Erica Friedman. Who is Erica Friedman? She is one of the world's most prominent pianists, piano salespersons. What is a piano? A fabulous, classy, expensive musical instrument. She is called the piano matchmaker. What's interesting is that a lot of people who have bought pianos from her actually go back to the why and the need. What they say is, we met Erica Friedman. She was such a classy woman, culturally so aware, so beautiful. We never needed a piano. We never wanted a piano, actually. We never even thought that, you know, in our living room, a piano would look fantastic in the setting. But what really appealed to us about Erica was that we wanted to be viewed and perceived as so culturally alive as her. So we wanted people to think when they look at us, wow, they are so culturally alive. It's not just people who have a lot of money, but these are people with a lot of grace and a lot of class. So we bought those pianos from Erica because we were connecting to that association we were making with her about being so classy. And we hope that through the purchase of that piano, which the world sees, and we tell people we bought it from Erica and we are so knowledgeable about it, people also start perceiving us as being very classy. So that piano actually only represented the need. They bought it for the why. They didn't buy it because they actually got up one morning and said, why do we need that piano? So we have to understand the why. I'm hoping that by now people have accepted that the why is important. It's not just another jargon that you need to go through in your course. You have to accept it to be able to genuinely work on it for each one of you. You're already part of that premium, which is your institute. Now, you have to go beyond that and make your individual personalities also that much more premium. And it's not a tough job to do. We can all do it every half an hour of our lives, every 1 hour of our lives, every day of our lives, and every week of our lives. And once we start doing it, we will realize how much better the response from the world is to us. So coming back to the why be a brand, it's a world of first among equals. Now imagine, as I had said, that there are 1,000 students who are up for 3 jobs of a Fortune 500 company. I'm the CEO of one of the Fortune 500 companies that comes down. I don't even tell anyone that I'm the person who's here to make this choice. I quietly circulate among the professors. I quietly circulate among the students and ask them about who are the people who stand out. Learn a little more about people. I will quietly be making my choice based on their conversations, based on their observations. And what are their conversations and observations going to lead to? It's going to lead to the students who are first among equals, who once again, let me keep emphasizing that, who stand out, who are the Katrina Kaifs and the Hrithik Roshans and the Salman Khans and the Sachin Tendulkars and the Mahendra Singh Dhonis of this institute. And that would have happened because they have caught everyone's eye about something which is different, which is positively different. Not only do they have it in their nature, but it has been professed. The world is aware of it. I may be a diamond in every inch of what I am, but as long as the world doesn't know that I am that diamond in every inch of my body and soul, what good is it to me? So if I'm a fantastic student, but the world just doesn't know about it, how will the world come to know that I'm a brand unto myself? So it's very, very important to be a brand, because you have to be first among equals. There's just too much competition in the world for us to assume if I come first or if I come second or if I come third, I'm there. A lot of times, first, second, third, people are not even aware of. It's someone else who may have been 25th or 100th in the class who has done something so exceptional, who may actually end up making the cut. This is not to take away from the focus that you should have on your academics or the focus you should have on your degrees. But that has to be holistically weaved in, with all of you standing out and being a little different. So why write it down on a piece of paper 10 times in front of you every morning that you wake up for the next 10 days? Why do I need to be a brand? I may have given you a few reasons. You may actually come up in your mind with 5 more reasons. And that will make this whole focus on being a brand that much more important to you, because you would have yourself understood why it's important. Moving on, why should I be a brand again? If I go and I want to buy, say a health supplement that I spoke about earlier, and I have a salesperson who walks up to me, who's totally haggard, disheveled, looking very dull and weak and half sick himself and coughing, and he's trying to sell me a health supplement, will I buy it from him? I'll run in the opposite direction and never buy that health supplement. Forget not buy it from him. I may never touch that health supplement also. Versus, if I come across a person who has a health supplement, who himself looks very fit, who himself looks, I'm in control. This is the car of my life and I'm very much behind the steering wheel of my car. I think I'll consider buying it from him, because he inspires confidence and faith in me. That's a very, very important aspect every time we go out, because there are so many products, there are so many services, there are so many people coming at you. So the person who inspires confidence gets the buy-in. And when I say buy-in, I'm not talking specific deal. It could be a job, it could be a sale of a product, it could purely be, getting nominated for something. That is what you need the buy-in for. When any of you go for your placements, whether it is through the institute or whether it is outside the institute, I think one very, very important thing that each one of you would be doing would be that you would be researching the company that you're going for your interview with. Don't you do that? We all go through their balance sheets. We go to their company websites. If we know people, friends whose parents work there, friends whose relatives work there, our professors know someone who work there, we do our information gathering about the company, not just so that we are well prepared for the interview, but also so that we know what is it that we are getting into. Who is this person who may hire me tomorrow and who I'm going to spend 9 to 6 of my day every day with, if not longer? What makes you think that over and above your CV, which has gone to the company, they are not doing their homework on you? So remember, homework on your counterparty, you vis-a-vis the company, and the company vis-a-vis you, is a two-way street. You are doing it, but they are also most certainly doing it. Most certainly doing it. So it's important that when they do the research on you, whether it is because they find something online about you, whether it is because they speak to your professors, whether it is because they quietly speak to your peers, it becomes very important to stand out then. So you have to understand the importance and sacredness of this reverse homework which is happening on you every day. When coaches come in the sports fraternity, in the sports field, when coaches come to pick, to select sports persons at district level, at state level, for a national level, they do it quietly. A lot of the times, the coach of the team doesn't even know that there is a selector sitting in the audience here. How is that selector making his call? He is, of course, looking at the performance of the sports person. But he's also looking at how that sportsperson stands out. We've seen movies like Chakde, we have seen movies like Iqbal about sports. They talk about selectors. So these selectors are those quiet parties in your world who are going out and doing their quiet homework, their reverse homework. So what happens if a good performer goes and maybe he has a bad performance day that day, but what if he just comes across as a really ill-tempered, not very personable, not very, amiable kind of person who really doesn't know who will make a mockery of the state or the country at an international level. Is he going to get picked despite his performance? Probably not. Chances are very high not. Because while his performance was there, his image management and brand management definitely wasn't there. So, very, very important to keep this in mind. When you go watch a movie, a big movie like a Chennai Express, the whole world knows about it. They have spent so much on their marketing spends, marketing budget. But when you go and watch a small movie which appeals to you, say like a Barfi, not so small, but relatively smaller. Even when their marketing happened, their publicity happened, it probably happened at a far more subtle level than a Chennai Express or a Ye Jawani Hai Deewani. Why did it become such a big success that supposedly it has grossed over 100 crores? Because word of mouth was strong. So when you go out and you say, XYZ movie was fantastic and Iqbal was a really good movie, or a Phans Gaye Re Obama was a very funny and good movie, you are doing brand management for that movie. And how sad is it? Don't we talk among ourselves? Movie was really nice, Pan Singh Tomar was really nice, but it didn't get the kind of box office success it should have got. We feel really bad when a good product doesn't get its due. So when you can feel bad about a movie not getting its due, what about you yourself? Your responsibility towards yourself is higher than your responsibility towards another product, which is a movie or a sports person or anyone else. So when there are so many products who are getting ahead because of imaging and branding and marketing, then it becomes each one of ours responsibility that a good product for sure must get its due. And that who is that good product? That good product is each one of you. It is your individual responsibility. Your professors can do so much. Your peers can do so much. Tomorrow you join a company, your supervisor can do so much. It is your whole and sole responsibility to ensure that you get your due. There is a very big public speaker in the West, Patricia Fripp. She's a very big PR agent. She made a very interesting statement. And while she talks about customers, here by customers I mean any counterparty that you deal with in your ecosystem and in your world. She says, it is the sole responsibility of the salesperson to ensure that his customer does not have a chance to forget him. It is not the responsibility of the customer to remember the salesperson. It is the sole responsibility and the obligation of the salesperson to ensure that the customer does not have a chance to forget him. You are the salesperson. Any counterparty that you deal with in the outside world is your customer. And it is your responsibility to ensure that you have highest recall. And how do you do that? You do that by being a brand. Hence, why be a brand? Let that echo and resonate again and again every day. Why be a brand? So I'm hoping that all of us have accepted and understood the importance of the why. None of us are left with, that's not a nice thing to do, it's showing off, it's blowing your own trumpet. If they're out of that zone, that's really good. Because once we've understood this, I can take you to the next aspect, which is the how. Once you've understood why you need to do your imaging, the next step is, how do you do it? Say I decide today, I have not worked on my branding, I have not worked on my imaging, let me start doing it. It's not going to happen overnight. You need guidance in terms of how to go about it. At a personal example, I remember very early on in my career, I had a supervisor who was very helpful in terms of tuning me in and alerting me to the need of why I need to be a brand and why I need to go through imaging. But when I asked him, I said, sir, you know, I really don't have a background where we've indulged in too much of, you know, talking about ourselves. Could you give me a little bit of guidance in terms of how I should go about doing it? I didn't really get that much of an input, which left me in a bit of a vacuum zone where I'm aware that I need to be a brand, but I'm frustrated that I don't know how to go about being a brand. Because being a brand doesn't mean saying, hey, look at me, please look at me. No, there is a very systematic and productive way of going about doing it. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to take you through a few suggestions which I have seen working for the world, for other people, which I have seen working for myself. It's not an exhaustive list. One mind has come up with five ideas. So many minds will come up with so many more ideas. So please feel free to keep adding your own ideas. Feel free to exchange notes with each other. See something that someone else is doing which you hadn't thought of. Indulge in it. But let me take you for the start through a few points which I feel would be helpful once you start moving on this path of being your own brand ambassadors. How to create a brand? Again, we come back to that unusual flavor, that extra cheese, that standing out. So what does standing out mean? I go out and spend lots of money and buy very expensive clothes and I come in an expensive car and everyone looks at me. No, no, no. That's okay for the superstars to do. You can do that once you have reached that status. But being individual brands is not about physical appearance and physical showmanship, outward showmanship. It's about showcasing your qualities. Think, each one of you, you're students in Velankar, you're pursuing various courses, management courses, other courses, but you are not only about academics, are you? As children, we all had our hobbies. So-and-so is good in singing, so-and-so is good in dancing, so-and-so is good in debating. What makes you think that those hobbies are not an important aspect of your life today just because you're studying a professional or a management course? They very much are important. They add that unusual flavor to you. It's not just that when you send a CV to a company, the last line in that CV says hobbies, traveling, reading, writing, and no one even looks at it. Think, introspect, have any of you achieved something phenomenal in one of your hobbies? For example, someone here may have won some very important dance competition or may have performed at public forums in some classical dance. Do you think that if I was looking at you from a job interview point of view, I will assess your qualities to be able to fulfill that role? But will I not also be impressed that you have accomplished and excelled in something other than that also? And if I'm looking at 100 CVs, and there are 100 CVs which talk only about grades and only about capabilities and only about work, and assuming all these are at par in terms of capabilities, will that one which gives me that unusual flavor not stand out? So highlight a unique quality or an interest or an achievement. What could these be? Someone could have been very good at cricket. Someone could have won some chess tournament. I remember interacting with this one CEO. He's a very big CEO. And everyone was talking about him, not because he has been at the helm of this bank and spearheaded that bank towards success, which everyone knows, which is a well-known fact. But people were so impressed because he had been a Ranji Trophy player. Now tell me, when I have 25 successful CEOs in front of me who have all done fantastic jobs as far as their companies go, will I not turn my head towards the person who stands out because of that? Also, keep in mind that it's not just about that extra flavor and that unique quality saying you've done something else. It also shows that you invest in yourself as a human being, which is a very important aspect in today's day and age. So if I have excelled as a sportsperson, where the CEO is a Ranji Trophy player, it also shows that he's competitive. It also shows that he's into fitness. Tomorrow when I'm judging 20 other people, maybe for an international CEO position, today he's a CEO in India, he will definitely be that first among equals that we spoke about earlier. So look at yourself. I would tell each one of you to pull out a sheet of paper, write three things which you may have excelled in. Or it's also possible that you have a hobby which you are pursuing, you have the capability to excel in, but you just haven't pursued it right now because you feel, I'm going to be a management graduate, I'm going to be an engineering graduate, so where does this add to my life? It absolutely adds to your life. It will give you that unusual flavor. If you already have excelled, fantastic. Weave it into your life. Talk about it. Let the world know about it gracefully. If you haven't excelled, think about excelling in it. Why not think about excelling in it? I'll give you a very personal example. 10 years ago, I was in a financial services company and there was a colleague of mine who was passionate about Bollywood. How many of us absolutely love Bollywood? What do? We go, we watch movies, fantastic. We have a great time with friends and family over the weekend. We go and watch it again if we like it. He was so passionate about it that he started writing reviews of movies. Now, keep in mind that this is a financial services professional who's my colleague, okay? He started writing movie reviews. Initially, he circulated them to, you know, his local newsletter. Gradually, someone took notice and one of these popular tabloids, daily tabloids, started carrying his reviews. We were all so impressed. Of course, he's a fantastic professional. He knows his financial services job really well. But even 10 years down the line today, I will never, ever, ever forget that gentleman or his name. I may forget 500 other people in the company who worked with me, but I will never forget him for that unusual flavor that he brought to his life, which did not in any way take away from his professional success or his professional capabilities. It only gave him that extra dash of goodness, which we can all do with. So keep in mind, if anyone ever tries to tell you that, you know, if you excel in something other than your work or other than your studies, then, you know, it's going to be misunderstood, because people will say that, you know, is he not concentrating on his job? Is he not concentrating on his studies? So has he taken away from that? Or maybe they'll just be indifferent to it. That is not the case. The old school, the very conservative school, 20 years ago may have thought that, but today there's a lot of respect for personal investment in that unusual flavor. So think about it. Keep in mind, it's a very small thing. We don't even realize how much people notice us because of that, but they do. They notice us, and they notice us very positively. And most important than not, it creates that recall, that responsibility that it is our job to ensure that people remember us. That responsibility this fulfills. So this is a very important tool on how to manage your brand.